Hello, I'm Lolly Bowean, a reporter and writer based in Chicago. My current role is as the Media and Storytelling Program Officer for the Field Foundation. It is my honor to be with you. Today, I am here to welcome you to the American Psychological Association's Main Stage Conversation. And of course, to thank you for your interest in this conference and for devoting your energy and attention to this timely and ever-important topic. As always, we hope today's discussions will simply serve as a starting point for a much more deeper and revealing conversation that you'll have later. Today, we're here to discuss the new way to work and how to make the best of this evolving workspace we are all currently experiencing. Last year, millions of us were forced to shift from office culture to working from home to help prevent the spread of COVID-19. Now, a whole year later, we want to more deeply understand what psychological and scientific research says about that shift that many of us experienced as we transitioned. I don't need to tell you that psychology plays a big role in how we redefine work, whether it's creating a healthy work environment, setting healthy work boundaries, or learning how to actively incorporate more diversity and inclusion in our workplaces and in our decision making. For so many of us, because of the pandemic, workplace and office culture has changed forever. We have been able to reimagine how we work, where we work, and what that work looks, feels, smells, and sounds like. Right now, there are conversations about returning to city centers and office buildings. But there are also some conversations emerging about hybrid models, flexible work schedules, and how to create an innovative work environment using all that we have learned during this past year. As a reporter working in the field, I wrote many news stories for the Chicago Tribune in coffee shops, in hotel lobbies, airport lounges, and sometimes even my car. It wasn't until the pandemic forced a quarantine that I actually began a work-from-home regimen. The first few weeks, I hunched over my laptop. So many times I had to turn to YouTube for tutorials to walk me through how to use technology that is simple for me today. Like so many of you, I adjusted. I got a larger monitor and an ergonomic work chair. I figured out how to adjust my work schedule so I could work when I was most productive and most attentive. So when I learned that we would be discussing the new workspace today, I couldn't help but think of the iconic writer and scholar Toni Morrison. In her essay, "The Work You Do, The Person You Are," Toni Morrison admitted that early in her life, work made her feel necessary. Work catapulted her from being seen as a possibly burdensome child to feeling like a contributing adult, she wrote. It was her father who offered her a new perspective on labor and the value of home life. During this work-from-home season, we have learned so many lessons. In his column printed in The Nation, the writer Eli Misto pointed out that some office cultures were subtly hostile to non-white employees. Working from home provided a shield from microaggressions and helped some Black and brown workers establish safe boundaries. Working from home also benefited some people with disabilities who often had to navigate barely ADA-compliant office spaces and public transit systems. In an article printed in Vox, it was pointed out that the new shift to working from home might disrupt just how we view typical office spaces, and it could even change how many of us feel about work. Yet, in a guest essay published in the New York Times, the manager of a Houston law firm wrote that he believes working from home actually drains morale and diminishes the collegial atmosphere. Not everyone can work from home or even in an office building. While the most privileged of us found ways to shift our work to more safe environments, hundreds and thousands of essential workers didn't have the same luxury. Women, especially mothers, found themselves working more and harder than before. So how do we navigate this new space with sensitivity and thoughtfulness? How do we, in our everyday work practices, stand for equity and equality? And what does all of this mean for the next stages of work? Well, today we're bringing you four speakers who have devoted their scholarship, their research, and intellectual energy in trying to understand workplace culture, mental health in the workplace, and the science of how our brains shift and adjust to work-life pressures. We will bring you a conversation with your very own CEO, Dr. Arthur Evans, with Johnny C. Taylor Jr., who is the President and Chief Executive Officer for the Society for Human Resource Management. They will talk candidly about the role psychology will play in creating a new, harmonious workplace. We'll also take a deep dive into the culture of remote work and what that means for the future. Joining us is Dr. Tsedal Neeley, who is the Naylor Fitzhugh Professor of Business Administration and the Senior Associate Dean for Faculty Development and Research at Harvard Business School. She recently published a book titled Remote Work Revolution, Succeeding from Anywhere, and we'll talk to her about that. I know many of us miss being together for this annual conference in person, but let me remind you, even in this virtual format, we are here for your questions and your feedback, so please use the chat feature. And don't forget to comment on Twitter and tag APA and use the hashtag APA2021 in your feedback there. Now, let's get started. Today, I'm joined by Dr. Kristen Shockley, an associate professor of psychology at the University of Georgia. Her research focuses on the intersection between employees' work and family lives. She works to find solutions on how organizations can foster environments to help their employees manage life demands. Please welcome Dr. Shockley.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
I want to jump right in, Dr. Shockley. For so many workers, the shift to remote work was abrupt and swift, and people were forced to adjust at a moment's notice last year. Can you talk a little bit about what that does to our psychology and what that does to our morale and spirits, having to pivot so quickly?
Yeah, so you're right. Most people had very little warning, and most organizations didn't really have a great plan in place, right, for the shift to remote work. So all of a sudden, people were told, okay, you're working from home. And a lot of people didn't have the work environment to really thrive, right? In some of our research we did in a grant funded through the National Science Foundation, we followed 500 people who had rapidly shifted to remote work. And we found one of the biggest predictors of their well-being was how comfortable their workspace was. So people who were working from the kitchen table, you know, or working in a chair that wasn't comfortable, those people tended to really struggle, which is not surprising. Additionally, there wasn't a lot of communication from many organizations about how people should be communicating once remote. You know, all of a sudden it was like, here's Zoom, start using it. Here's a VPN. And so without adequate training, you know, there was a really big learning curve there in the beginning for people to really figure out how to make remote work work. But then I think, you know, a month or two in, people were pretty stable and functioning fairly well, considering that we were in the middle of a pandemic. Our research showed that people's stress levels were about the midpoint on a 5-point scale. And most people had said that they were quite fairly well adjusted in general.
How did people make that adjustment? What were the simple steps that they took to make those stress levels sort of even out, to make it a less abrupt shift or a stressful shift into one that was more settling?
Yeah, one thing that we've seen a lot of discussion about is people kind of emulating their old work routines, but in the new environment. So you may have heard discussion of the fake commute. And that is one way that people were kind of signaling to their mind and their body that work was starting, you know, or that work was ending at the end of the day. So that allows people to easily transition between the roles. So I heard discussion about that. Also, a big issue was because kids were home during the beginning of the pandemic, right? It was really hard for people to focus. So it was understanding how to maintain those boundaries, a lot of which was trying to have a separate workspace with a door and just communicating with family members that this is the time when I need to be working and focusing on work, and particularly communicating with the spouse if you have a spouse that was also working from home and you both had to take care of the kids. So I think it required a lot more just thinking about daily habits to get the hang of it.
Did your research reveal any patterns of how people readjusted their work days? As you know, typically before the pandemic, many of us went into offices or we went to our workplace and we were there for 8 hours straight. Have people adjusted their schedules to work differently?
Yeah. So we saw some people who were really preserving those same hours, you know, let's say 9 to 5, and were really strict with it. But we saw a greater proportion that were actually working longer throughout the day. So it was not a clear start and stop time, right? So they, you know, might wake up, check their email, drink their coffee on their front porch, come back in, you know, and then work until later in the night. So I think for some people that may have worked well, but for a lot of people that caused this blurring between boundaries, which can make it just kind of difficult. You always feel like you're on, right? And always connected. And I think in some ways, organizations kind of took advantage of that with expecting people to start responding more frequently. So I think that's something, you know, hopefully when we start to go back into the workplace, that blurring will stop and people will feel a little bit more of that sense that they can disconnect from the workplace.
I'm smiling at you because you said when we go back to the workplace, but in many ways, hasn't the workplace just kind of transitioned? Isn't it just a whole different mental space?
Yeah, I think for a lot of people, we'll see how, I think for a lot of workers, that's the case. We'll see how organizations respond. You know, we're still kind of in this great experiment because we're still in a pandemic, right? But I think we'll start to see a lot more hybrid arrangements. So companies recognizing, all right, people just worked for a year remotely. We can't really say you have to come back all the time. A lot of people don't want that. And you're already starting to see that, for example, with Amazon. You know, they said everybody has to come back, and then a lot of people threatened to quit or quit. And so they rolled that back. So I think we'll see more hybrid arrangements where you have a few days a week in the office and a few days a week at home, which is kind of the best of both worlds, right? Because then you get some of that flexibility, some of the benefits of remote work, like no commute, more time to do other things. But you also don't lose that social connection, you know, which is one thing that really the big downside of remote work is a lot of people in our study said they felt socially isolated. So, you know, I do think we will have a new normal, so to speak. And I think it's an interesting time because it's rare that something really forces so much change like the pandemic did. And I think people are just going to demand more flexibility moving forward for sure.
Now, I realize that you're still in the midst of your research. You mentioned the grant that you got shortly after the pandemic and how you're taking an in-depth look at what remote work means for workers and for employers. Can you talk about the advice that you would give to employers as we start to adjust to new models and even to employees as we begin to really think about this evolving space?
Yeah. So we actually asked this question in our grant. We said, what's the one piece of advice you would give to managers to better support you in your remote work? And so I'll tell you some of the things we saw. The first one was just flexibility and understanding, right? I think that's kind of common sense. Like, again, recognizing that flexible work tends to be better for everyone. It worked really well for a lot of people. And understanding that we still are in a pandemic and that there's still going to be things that come up, like schools closing, people having to quarantine, that kind of thing. A second thing people said was for managers to encourage people to take breaks. And so a greater focus and understanding of the importance of breaks on mental health and how important that is to people to be able to function in the workplace. So I think working from home kind of allowed a little bit more break taking. So as people go back into the office, hopefully that break taking will become a little bit more of a norm, even if you're in person. And then a third thing that we saw was just to have some more organizational initiatives that actually support remote work. So that goes back to some of the stuff I was talking about before with having a good workspace. So one thing, organizations are going to start saving money because they don't need as much real estate if everybody's not, you know, always in the office all the time. And so using that for programs that, you know, giving money to support getting a better workspace or programs that help like with mental health, such as like mindfulness training techniques, relaxation techniques, those kind of things. And then for employees, I would just say, you know, think about, you know, what worked for you and what's important for you. And we sort of have this kind of reset. So you can really talk, this is the time to talk to your manager and be able to state, I think, more firmly sort of any shifts that you need in your work arrangement for you to be functioning at the highest level you can.
In some ways, the pandemic forced many of us to slow down and to really take stock of our mental and emotional health. In the workplace, too, managers and leaders were forced to reckon with their employees' well-being and their employees' mental health. How might this awareness translate to our work life after the pandemic is over?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think one of the main things that I'm seeing from my research is, from a mental health standpoint, is just how important a social connection at work is. We had a question in our study about people seeing a new side of their colleagues. And a lot of people indicated that they did, that they felt like they had this glimpse into people's lives that they had never seen before, right? And they also indicated, wow, I didn't realize like how much I missed this person, or how much this person kind of meant to me. And so I think that when we had that removed, right, it became very obvious during the pandemic. So I think that that's one thing that organizations have seen, the need to keep fostering that social connection. And so we'll see more focus on, well, what can you do in the workplace when people are face-to-face to foster that, but also what can you do virtually? And a lot of companies were doing like these Zoom happy hours, but we kind of know that's not really the same. It doesn't really quite work that great. People start to sort of dread them. So I think we'll start to see some more innovation around like, how can you make meaningful connections if people aren't necessarily located in the same place? And then again, I think you'll start to see more organizational offerings that support mental health, like the relaxation or mindfulness training that I mentioned before. And then also I'm starting to see discussion of acceptance of mental health days, like we have sick days. And that no one questions if you have the flu. No one should question, you know, if you need to take a day off because, you know, you need it for mental health reasons. So I hope that will start to become a more sort of acceptable excuse for taking a personal day.
I'm glad that you brought up the social connections and the social interactions at work. Working at home provided a shield from microaggressions and helped some Black and Brown employees establish safe boundaries. Working from home also benefited people with disabilities who sometimes had trouble navigating the traditional office spaces or were forced to take barely ADA compliant public transit to get to work. Can you talk about how this shift to work from home to then into these hybrid models, how we can preserve some of that safe space for people who have found a haven in working from home?
Yeah, I think that's a really good point that you bring up. And it's interesting because those of us who study teleworking have been saying this for a long time. Like, there's all these benefits that you're not seeing. And then finally, when we got forced into it, you know, people are starting to see it. So I think the main way is to still allow some of the remote work to happen, right? If we think about accommodating people with disabilities, I think, you know, that's a big part of it. In terms of the microaggressions and things that relate to, you know, maybe organizational, more like cultural type factors, that's where I think it's important to sort of take stock, for organizations to take stock of and talk to employees that are in that situation. You know, why was it so much better during the pandemic? What was it that was removed? Was it just that you weren't physically around other people? Or was there something else? And then really thinking, well, how can we apply that same idea to when we are physically in the same place? I think the recognition of it is really the critical first step, and then diagnosing it and then making change from there.
I wanted to talk to you too about burnout. Some of us have started to talk about camera and meeting fatigue, and meetings that stretch into the night or that are in off hours early in the mornings to accommodate some of our colleagues and their schedules. Can you talk about how do we effectively cut off work when work and home feel the same?
Yeah. And that's really been a big struggle for a lot of people. It's really hard to keep them separate when they're in the same environment. And it's hard to feel like you have a valid excuse for stopping work when your desk is, you know, always right in front of you. But that's where I think it's really important to lay those clear boundaries with work. And we're doing some research right now where we're finding that people who have clear conversations with both their family about interrupting their work and their people at work about, you know, the hours when they are available are tending to see more benefits in terms of, you know, things like burnout and their stress levels. You know, burnout's happening to a lot of people right now, I think, because the pandemic's, you know, still going on. And the real big way to combat it is just to be able to take a break. So it's really critical to have those conversations and to establish those boundaries for sure.
Earlier in this conversation, you talked about mindfulness training. I'm curious as to what you would say in terms of how we can demonstrate as colleagues that we are supportive and that we are compassionate toward each other as we navigate these evolving times. I would guess that many in our audience are similar to me, that we've been working from home, then we've shifted into a hybrid model, and now as the variant becomes more apparent and is impacting more people, we're shifting back to the full-time work from home model. How do we remain compassionate and sensitive to each other during these times where it just continues to shift and change?
Yeah. I think that's where it's all about communication. In our study, we found people said, just check in with each other. And it goes a long way, right? Just sending people an email being like, hey, is everything okay? How are you doing? And they said that from the manager's point of view, but I think that's the same with colleagues. Just being vocal in expressing that you do care about how somebody's doing, communicating that to them. But, also recognizing we all have really different situations, right? We have different situations at home. We have different levels of risk associated with getting COVID. And so, recognizing somebody may acting in a way that's different than what you are, but it's probably because they have a totally different situation and just trying to be really understanding of that.
Yeah, I really like that point of checking in with each other because that's what we do almost every day when we would see each other in person at work. We got that, how are you? But now that we're a little disconnected, we have to make a conscious choice to really reach out to each other and make sure that we're okay. I know that some of your past research, Dr. Shockley, revealed that men had just as much conflict around work-life balance as women. I'm curious, this shift to work from home, has that impacted the dynamic? Are women still sort of carrying the burden of doing a lot of the homework or home-related work? Has it balanced out any? What has your research revealed?
Yeah, so we did a study, and I think we launched it 2 weeks after the stay-at-home orders happened. So this was still really very new. And it was all dual earner couples with kids under age 6. So they were dealing with daycares just closed. Like, what are we going to do? And we asked them, what strategies are you using? Because they both still had to work and care for the kids. And then we followed up with them 2 months later to see how different strategies related to well-being. And one out of every 5 people in our study were in the wife does it all group, meaning the wife was doing all of the childcare. And then 10% were in the wife does most of it. So she was just getting occasional help. And there were some egalitarian groups, but there was only 6% where the husband was doing most or all. So it's certainly quite lopsided, right? I think that's one big thing we've seen in this pandemic is once there were childcare issues, it fell back on traditional gender roles where women were taking up a lot of the labor, women were disproportionately dropping out of the workforce. And, it's pretty daunting because we don't know what the long-term impact of that is going to be, right? Even a short interruption in a career can have a long-term impact on salary and that kind of thing. So I think some of the progress we made in equality was a little bit backtracked during the pandemic, unfortunately.
Does it help at all that we're more aware in this moment that the housework and the childcare work is falling upon women and that we've had such a rush of women to leave the workplace?
Yeah, there is some research that suggests just awareness about inequality does help men step in and do a little bit more. So to the extent that people are paying attention to these statistics, yes, it should have an impact. But how much people are paying attention is hard to say.
What should organizations do to step in and disrupt this cycle?
Yeah, that's kind of the million-dollar question, I think. As someone who's interested in gender, I think one thing is when we looked at this, I said we linked it to well-being. So the people who were in the group where the wife does it all, not surprisingly, they had the most marital tension, they had the most psychological distress, right, and worst job performance. But it wasn't just for the wives, it was for the husbands too. Because if you think about it, if you're in a situation where the wife's doing everything, like it's just probably a lot of fighting going on, right? Just a lot of tension. And so that finding to me is really interesting for organizations. It's like, even if it's not the person who works for you that's having the issue, if it's falling on their spouse, it's still going to be creating issues that affects their job performance. So I think offering flexibility, generally speaking, no matter somebody's gender, can really be important to help support that. But beyond that, I think some of it might be a broader government or state issue in terms of we don't have much safety nets in place for what to do in these situations. And it can't just like have women keep shouldering the burden like this if it happens in the future.
Wow. Yes. I'm so glad that you brought that up, especially how flexibility can help. And that tension on the mother figure or the matriarch in the family also equals tension on the patriarch in the family as well. So, no, really good points. Those are actually all the questions that I have right now, Dr. Shockley. I know our time is coming to a close, but I want to make sure that you can, that you have expressed everything that you think is important. Is there anything you want to add or say that I haven't asked you about?
No, I guess I would just add that I think hybrid is the way of the future, and we don't have a ton of research on it, so it's sort of an exciting time for us to live it and study it and make work as good as it can be for both organizations and employees.
Do you have an idea from your research what hybrid is going to look like? Does that mean few days at the office or more days at the office and few at home?
So what previous research pre-pandemic has shown is that it's actually the ideal situation is 2 days at home and 3 days in the office. So to the extent that that carries over, you know, I think that seems like a good balance. But figuring out, do people get to choose which days? Are you trying to make it organized in a way that certain days when people need to have meetings, you know, you might have days when people tend to do tasks that involve like tasks that involve like critical thinking, where they don't need interruptions, better at home. But then brainstorming type things that require a lot of communication, those are better in the office. So it's the challenge of scheduling it so that the right people are there at the right time, I guess, and how to manage all of that. So these are just really new questions that I think is going to be exciting to study moving forward.
Yeah, you've already got me thinking about which days I would want to be in the office. I'm thinking Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, right?
Yeah, it would be a long weekend, right?
Probably like a lot of people who want that 4 days in a row. Thank you so much for these insights, Dr. Shockley. Where can people find you on social media? Where can they learn about your work?
So if you look at the University of Georgia website and search for Kristen Shockley, you'll find a link to my lab website, which has all of my different publications. And I am on Twitter as @KShockles.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us today. I appreciate your insight.
Thank you, Lolly.
Joining me now is Dr. Tsedal Neeley, a professor at Harvard Business School who has been studying remote work for nearly 2 decades. Dr. Neeley, earlier in my introduction of you, I mentioned that you published a book earlier this year, Remote Work Revolution, Succeeding from Anywhere, which is so very timely. You know that this pandemic forced many of us into remote working. At this moment that we're having this conversation, you and I, some employers have begun talking about moving from a strictly work from home to a hybrid model. But at the same time, the Delta variant is becoming more gripping, and that's forced us to have discussions about whether a hybrid model is even healthy right now. I want to start this conversation by hearing from you on what you recommend for us in navigating this space where we're trying to make sense of this ever-evolving work environment.
First of all, thank you for having me. I think that we really need to be very flexible on how we navigate the return to work and really take advantage of remote work in the meantime. And even once we decide whichever hybrid format we adopt, it's important to know that at any given time, we may have to go all remote based on physical safety, psychological safety, and readiness of each of our environments. And we've seen a number of organizations not only postpone their return to work by a month or two, some are even looking to 2022. The uncertainty of this global pandemic has to be very front center in how we think about our return, particularly ensuring that we're adaptive, flexible, and that we're equipped for the shifts and changes that are inevitable.
Do you have some suggestions on how we can be practical, like some actual steps that we can take as employees to sort of deal with this shift? How should we prepare our workspace at home, for example, so that we're flexible enough to go to an office, but also work from our desk if we need to?
I've had so many conversations with not only people that have started the return to work, but also designers and architects that have been looking at and thinking about this new work environment. And one of the things that's become clear is there's a central point where we do a lot of our work, even if we're hybrid, like our home office that have been outfitted in effective ways for the most part. And when we go to the office, we'll need our work bags, and typically, if we have them, our laptops or whatever devices we're using. In some organizations, they're even starting to set up lockers for people to put their valuables in and spend time in collaboration environments. Because when we go back to the office, we want to be very clear the purpose of the office work, and collaboration, innovation, connection tend to be the three reasons people go into the office, which means you'll end up being with others, sharing space with others. And so you don't need a lot for that, but you need to make sure that, you know, all of our physical spaces are safe to be able to do that.
So it sounds like instead of just going back to the office to be there, that we need to have a really focused and strategic plan on what we're going to do when we get to those offices.
100%. People are showing exactly what they value since this pandemic has hit and the remote work experience has set. People want work-life flexibility, meaning that if we are to go into our physical in-person spaces, it has to be for the type of tasks and collaborations that are different than the things that we can do at home. If you ask, and this is, we have data on this, if you ask people to come back to the office to do the exact same things that they could be doing at home, but now you're adding the stress of commuting, you're adding the stress of dealing with home life, and the stress of additional financial expenses just for them to sit at home at work and do the exact same thing, they do not want that. They're rejecting that. And for some, it's been even cause for leaving their organizations.
Yeah, I definitely can understand what you're saying, especially about flexibility. Now, flexibility can help some workers, but then not having that official barrier between work and home can also lead to overworking and eventually burnout. How do you recommend navigating that dual reality that we want to be focused when we go to the office and make sure that we're doing specific tasks, but we also don't want to burn ourselves out working extra hours at home just because we can?
I call that hyper productivity. That's productivity gone wrong. When we're blurring work and non-work to the extent that we are plugging in so many hours that we end up burning out. And when we burn out, it's no good for ourselves. It's no good for our home life. It's no good for our teams. It's no good for our organizations. A number of organizations have collected data on this very recently and have learned that, in fact, their most senior people are the most burned out. Now, why is that bad? That's bad because their most senior people are making decisions every single day for their employees' welfare, for their stakeholders, their customers, clients, partners, and ecosystems. And so do you want your senior people whose brains are half asleep and, you know, it's kind of like not present to make important decisions that today in the middle of a global pandemic is a life and death type of decision for others. So it's really important that we scale back. And some organizations like Ernst & Young are actively asking their people to work less because the hyper productivity has been so evident and they know it's unsustainable.
Wow, that really makes the case for having a work-life balance, because you're absolutely right. You don't want the leadership of your firm to be so burned out that they're not making sound decisions, particularly when it comes to the welfare of the rest of the employees. And since we're talking about leadership, one of the things that you write about in your book is the need for leaders to become adept at leading what you call a distributed workforce, where some are working in an office, some are working remote, and that people are in different places. What specific suggestions do you have for leaders who are trying to develop these very new management skills?
So first, I think you hit it right on the head. These are new management skills, and to recognize that they are, there are new practices to bring to bear as opposed to trying to cycle in old methods of working. Because in a sense, a distributed workforce means that we will be dealing with groups where some people will be in our spaces, our physical spaces, others will not be. And there's some natural and detrimental aspects of that structure I just described that emerges naturally. It's a structural issue, which leads to the us versus them phenomenon, first and foremost. So leaders have to always work hard to ensure that they're working on the team bonding, team building, and also having everyone understand their shared goals and their shared purpose. The other thing that particularly those who are not sharing the same space as the leader feel is either some people call it FOMO, fear of missing out, others call it proximity bias, but it's this deep fear that if I'm not in the same space as my leader, will they know that I'm working just as well, just as hard, and deserve to grow in my career? So smart leaders in a virtual or distributed environment ensure that they're helping everyone develop equally, and ensure that whether you're in person or not, everyone is treated well and explicit. The leaders have to be explicit about this as they deal with their own teams, as well as others in the organizations. And finally, meetings have to be inclusive. You have to invite people in. You have to monitor airtime and not let it unfold organically. So this is part of a distributed leadership model. You are ensuring that you're inclusive in your philosophy, you're inclusive, your behaviors each and every day.
Yeah. And so it sounds like there are new skills that leaders are going to have to be deliberate about developing if they really want to cultivate a work from home model or a hybrid model to be successful. I want to shift a little bit and talk about job performance measures then. This mass shift to remote working has meant that some of the job performance measures that we used to use no longer apply. For example, getting to the office before the boss was seen as a good thing, or team building by being that colleague who brings in donuts or fruit on Fridays was viewed as something that really bonded you to your colleagues. But now that we're working remotely, what ways can leaders evaluate their employees' performance? What things should we be thinking of as employees to demonstrate that we're self-starters, that we're go-getters, and that we're high achievers and valuable to our managers?
So what you're talking about is the fact that gone are the days when we're talking remote, when we're talking hybrid, when butts and seats and time, shared time and space is the only way to recognize people's performance and reward them accordingly. Today, we need to adopt what the late, great, pioneering teams scholar Richard Hackman has taught us, which is to measure performance based on output, as opposed to micromanaging process, while empowering and equipping people to be able to do that. So to look at results and helping people achieve those results through empowerment and capabilities building. The second thing that Richard Hackman says is that we look at performance and effectiveness by the cohesion of the group. So leaders need to not only look at individuals and what they're doing, but how are they contributing to the oneness of their group? And leaders have to help facilitate that. And lastly, the third measure that Richard Heckman says is crucial in this kind of context is individual growth and individual well-being. Individuals have to not only have job satisfaction and learning as a result of being in these remote groups, but they have to feel like they're fully connected with others. So personal isolation and other things are terrible for performance. So outcome, cohesion, and individual growth and well-being then become the things that we nurture, cultivate, and the metric by which we measure individual performance and our group performance.
Wow. You know, there are those of us who are able to make that switch to working remotely fairly easily. We adapted. One of the things you just brought up was working in isolation and possible feelings of being lonely. Those employees who were excited to go back to the office and who say that they need this social contact in order to thrive, what can we do in this environment to support those employees if remote working continues or if the company decides to go fully remote?
That's an excellent question, because there are, when you look at the data across many surveys that have been gathered, including those from the Harvard Business School, what you'll find is about 15 to 17% of respondents across surveys want to go back to the office. And they tend to be people who don't have great working conditions. It could be because of space. It could be because of noise. It turns out that the kids and pets that I love to see on my video calls can be very distracting because they bring what's called ambient noise. And of course, other things too, if they're trying to, you know, walk across your keyboard. The other thing is young people who may have felt such professional isolation and concerns about developing in their professional careers if they're sitting home alone. Those folks want to go into the office. But the reality is we need to remind people that the office environment, even though we've been experimenting with the return, has changed. The place we left is not the place we're going back to. So the number of people around will be different. And some people who've been in that category that you describe and gone back to work have found themselves sitting in a large space, even lonelier at work than they were at home. So we need to think about what is the critical mass that we need to ensure we have assembled at the workplace for this to work for those who can go back. For those who cannot, if an organization is saying we're going to be all remote, then it becomes incredibly important that in the structure of the work, that personal and professional connections and contact are maintained. And that can happen in a hybrid way. That can happen in an in-person way as well, so that you can say, you know what, every 3 weeks we're going to get together for 3 hours and either spend time thinking about work or spend time thinking about our relationship. So there are different things that you can do, if at all possible. It gets tougher if people are in different states, but that's a whole other issue as well. How do you integrate a workforce that's distributed, which is a problem that many organizations have been dealing with for a very long time. It's not new.
Yeah. What I appreciate, Dr. Neeley, is that you are recommending strategies and just the fact that we need to have one. I think so many of us have just kind of got tossed into this remote work situation, and now we really need to build a real infrastructure on how to get this work done. Thank you so much for this wonderful conversation. I feel like I could ask you questions forever about it, but instead I'll just recommend that all of our viewers pick up your book, Remote Work Revolution. Thank you again for being here today.
Thank you so much for having me. Loved having this conversation with you.
Hi. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon for the American Psychological Association's 2021 convention and our first main stage live conversation, Making the Most of a New Way to Work. Again, I'm Lolly Bowean, a reporter and writer in Chicago, and I'm so happy to serve as your host. Joining me this afternoon are two leaders who are going to share their insights with us. First, we'll start with Dr. Arthur Evans Jr., who is the Chief Executive Officer and Executive Vice President for the American Psychological Association, someone we all know. Thank you so much for being here. Good afternoon, Dr. Evans.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Yeah. I don't know about you, but I definitely enjoyed that conversation with Dr. Shockley and Dr. Neeley. I feel like this is the conversation we're all having at this moment. Are we going to go back to an office? Are we going to continue working remotely? Are we going to just all work from home or work from a hybrid model? We've already established through that conversation that the pandemic forced millions of people who normally went into an office to work from home for the first time. But as you know, Dr. Evans, this came at a really emotionally intense time when workers were managing grief, uncertainty. There was a lot of rapid change around us, among other things. Since you run a large organization with a large staff, can you talk to me about the psychological impact on your employees? What were the signs of mental distress, and how were you able to manage it when you're managing so many personalities and just so many people?
Yes, I mean, you're exactly right. One of the things that we have really stressed throughout the pandemic is that this is as much a psychological event as it is a physical event, because most people are focused on the virus and the transmission of the virus. But we know that there was a huge psychological impact. Our Stress in America survey, for example, showed that we had extremely high levels of stress that started at the beginning of the pandemic, and they just increased over the course of the pandemic. It stayed pretty high as we, you know, are at this point in the process. But, you know, we were concerned about a lot of different things, like a lot of organizations. We were concerned about the stress. One of the things that happens in a virtual environment is that the lines between work and home life are very blurry. And for some of us who already have that problem, it just got exacerbated. Not naming any names, but some of us have challenged with that throughout our career. And so it got worse for many of us. And so it was not uncommon for people to be working 12, 15-hour days, you know, because you're in the same place that you work and you live. And so we were very concerned about that at the very beginning of the pandemic. All of us had to pivot and to lean into it, and that was appropriate. But what I was concerned about was sustaining that level of effort over a long period of time. And so we did some things to be very intentional about trying to help people be, number one, conscious of what was happening to all of us, and then take proactive steps. You know, we talked about the importance of understanding the difference, the connection between our physical health and our mental health. And that one of the things that we wanted people to pay more attention to was, are you sleeping? You know, are you getting enough sleep? Are you eating right? Watching weight. We know that people's weights went up quite a bit over the course of the pandemic. We talked about the importance of social support and how we had to be much more intentional, because we were socially isolating from people and from organizations that may have provided support. And so we wanted people to be more conscious of that. We had mental health days because we knew that even though we were asking people to pull back some, we also knew that we have some very high performing, energetic employees, and that it was really hard. And so we actually gave people mental health days, a couple of mental health days, and we sent out an edict that no one was to do email. And so those kinds of things, I think, recognized that people were having these challenges. But as an organization, we bore some responsibility in helping people through that.
Yeah. And so it sounds like from a management perspective, you were able to implement some policies like the wellness days to ensure that employees had that space and time to take care of themselves and that they were not bringing on too much stress or overworking themselves. We're also joined today by Johnny C. Taylor, who is the president and chief executive officer for the Society for Human Resource Management, also known as SHRM. Thank you so much for joining us. Johnny, I want to shift to you to kind of, talk a little bit too about the signs of mental distress and how, from a human resources perspective, it can be managed in large organizations. You know, what could be done from a sort of foundational level to ensure that employees are getting what they need, especially if they're not in the office where human resources professionals can see what they're experiencing.
Well, thank you all. Thank you for allowing me. And Dr. Evans, I was listening in and could not agree with more with you, everything that you've said. So I don't need to repeat that. And he's the expert, right? But how this is playing itself out at work is really the issue. When you think about it, we spend most of the time that we're not awake at work. And so the role that employers play in overall wellness and mental wellness is critical. So let me make one point that that I think will serve foundationally for this. Prior to the pandemic, when we talked about wellness, we were largely talking about physical wellness. I mean, you know, smoking cessation programs, we were giving away Fitbits, we were doing all of those things to make sure that you were physically okay. There was scant real focus on mental wellness. And while we all offered typically as a part of our overall health and benefit programs, EAP, the EAP programs were capped, you know, 3 or 4 50-minute sessions, and magically you were supposed to be well. We would have never done the same thing if someone needed cancer treatment or prolonged kidney dialysis treatment. We didn't cap those things. But when it came to mental health, what we as employers were saying was, it's not as important. So what the pandemic did, and we all focus on the negatives associated with the pandemic, but there's some real positives. It allowed us, it called on us, demanded that we focus more on mental health and well-being. And that when we talk wellness, we're not just talking about physical wellness, but we're also talking about mental and emotional wellness. That's something I'm very excited about. As I said, sometimes when I say, you know, nothing is always bad, there are really some benefits to the pandemic, and this was one of them. For the human resources professional, and I will get to your point about the people who are working remotely, but particularly we focused on at the outset, how do we provide for the people who are struggling with their balancing their daily lives and the needs of us at work? Like, how do we ensure that that single mother who's now tasked with being not just a mother, an employee, but now she's a teacher and a social worker and a healthcare worker. She's doing all of that at once. How do we as an employer sensitize ourselves to that such that, you know, it's mutually beneficial? We want to do it because it gives us a sufficient return on our investment in people. We want that person to show up and be productive. And at the same time, we want that employee to have an overall well life. And so we had to think about, how do you do this when at least March, April, June or so last year, and for some companies still, employees are working remotely. Like, how can I figure out if this person is a victim of domestic abuse, which we saw an increase of that during the pandemic? If the person were coming to work, we could see that he or she, there were physical manifestations of it, behavioral changes that we could observe. That's very, very difficult, made incredibly difficult when the person's on the other side of a screen. And oftentimes they don't even turn your screen on, right? So you're just getting the voice. So we did a few things in the HR practice. One, we began more and more destigmatizing mental health, making it okay for employees to talk about it and for us to have the same level of concern that we had about, you know, the person who says, listen, I've cancer, when someone said, I'm suffering from depression, or I'm struggling with just getting out of bed every day, as opposed to holding them accountable for being on time and all of that. We said, let's figure out why. And is this the manifestation of someone who's struggling mentally and emotionally? So we had to go a long way to say, it's okay to talk about it. in the workplace. And the more you do that, then we needed to make sure that we had appropriate intervention. So many of us, secondarily, in addition to destigmatizing it, we then went the next step and we went to our what we call EAP providers, the employee assistance providers, and we said, take the cap off. It's not okay to give people 3 or 4 visits per year. Take the cap off. We want you to upgrade the quality of the people who are on the other side of the phone when this person calls. So this isn't just, you know, a customer taker, an order taker. This is someone we want trained professionals to answer those calls to help people through these issues, just as we would want trained medical professionals on the phone for someone who is struggling with a physical problem or suffering with a physical problem. That was the second thing that we did. And then we went into some very intense training with people managers, not just HR people, but the people managers on the front line to say, these are the things you have to look for. We need to train you so that you know what to look for so that then you alert us in HR and we can give you the appropriate interventions. We here at SHRM have had a number of incidences where people have either tried to commit suicide and one who unfortunately was successful. And what we realized is that that frontline people manager did not know the signs. And so it was our job, and we made it, we really messaged this not throughout SHRM, not just throughout SHRM, but throughout our membership, that we've got to train people managers how to be on the lookout for signs of mental and emotional distress.
Wow, you have really touched upon so many issues, Johnny, that I want to make sure that Dr. Evans can kind of jump in and help us unpack. One of the things that you talked about is noticing the signs of mental distress and how if we're working remotely, we may not see that. Also, as we've transitioned to remote work, we've kind of lost some of the personal connection to our colleagues. We don't see the signs of mental distress, but we also don't know if one of our colleagues if their child is excelling in a sports league, or if they're now caring for an aging parent or growing their family by adopting. It's as if some of that casual intimacy that we once had with each other has abruptly been taken away from us. What does that do to us as employees, Dr. Evans? What does it mean for our relationships with each other? And how do we manage or sort of kind of heal back some of that we've lost during this pandemic?
Yeah, sure. You know, I think of you know, all the things that I'm concerned about as a CEO that are missing in a virtual environment. It is exactly that. It's those casual interactions that we have. And as you pointed out, Lolly, they have multiple impacts, or there are multiple ways that those casual impacts are important. As Johnny mentioned in what he was saying, sometimes they help us to detect when our colleagues and friends are in distress or they're having challenges, which we can't do in a virtual environment. You know, one of the things I'm concerned about as a CEO is that a lot of the great ideas that I have been able to implement or things that we've worked on as an organization have not happened in a formal meeting. They've happened because of an informal connection or contact that I had someone drop by and you know, we had a really interesting conversation. So that piece is missing. The social connection piece is also missing. We know that social support is extremely important to all of us, and many of us get important social support from our colleagues at work. So in all of those ways, that casual connection that you're talking about is missing in a virtual environment. And I think to the degree that we remain virtual, and I think all of us are going to be more virtual coming out of this than we were going into this, we have to then be intentional about leaders and as organizational folks to make sure that we are intentional about overcoming that and having strategies to compensate for that missed casual connection. And I gotta tell you, right now, I don't know, you know, our previous two speakers were great because they know the literature, they know what the research is out there. And, you know, one of the things that I heard very clearly is that we don't have a lot of research around many of the important aspects of virtual and working in hybrid environments. And we're gonna learn a lot over the next several years as we do this. I will tell you as a leader, though, I am very focused on not only what are the decisions that we're making as we go through this, but how do we set up a learning organization so that we're learning and we're taking those learnings and moving them forward as we go through this process.
Daca, if I could chime in there too, one of the things, if I may, one of the things that you know, bothers me is we hear a lot, and the media is responsible for it, and it's just taken on a world of its own, but that everyone wants to work remotely. Well, first of all, that it misses the point. What we don't talk about is nearly half, arguably somewhere between 42% and as much as 60% of the U.S. workforce never enjoyed the luxury of working remotely. So when you hear everyone's doing it, you forget the 2.2 million people who work at Walmart, right? The largest employer in our country. And the idea to suggest that those people aren't real employees is a little dismissive and unfair. And by the way, they index largely Black and Brown. So it's a whole bunch of issues tied up in that, like the knowledge workers are the only real workers, and the rest of those people, you know, they're not really working or they're not valued. That's a problem. A lot of people's jobs required that they continue to work throughout the pandemic in person. And that carries with it its own stress as well. So it's not just the people who are working remotely who had to deal with these issues, but then the people who were forced to come into work. Think about the person who works at Walgreens. Hell, I joke and say they knew most of the people walking into their stores were sick. They run pharmacies, right? So these people are walking literally into the fire every day in the middle of a pandemic. And the notion that we only talk about the stresses of the people or the stressors of the people who are working remotely kind of misses the point. So it's just really important for me to make the point that a significant number of American workers, and it's bigger than just the first line, you know, police, firefighters, that kind of stuff. It's also people who had to go to work throughout it. That's number one. Number two is our research at SHRM tells us that employees were not asking for remote work. They were asking for flexibility. And there is a difference. Fully remote, very few, and I mean, you're the psychologist and everything, so you'll be able to talk about this, but generally speaking, human beings like to belong, work with other people. That's why we talk about belonging and inclusion and all of that, right? So what we heard from employees is, we're just not sure that we need to be in the office every day, 9 to 5, the traditional workforce schedule, right? That's a 1930s concept. But we're not saying also that we want to sit at home by ourselves and never leave the four walls of the buildings that we live in. Like, that doesn't work either. So what they were saying was flexibility. When done right, the companies that I think are overcompensating with, oh, everyone can work remotely, are ignoring the fact that human beings really do, at least in our research is telling us from a social science standpoint, that they want to, you know, mix and work with other people. They want the water cooler conversations, the walks around the park, around the campus, whatever. They want and desire that. None of us want to be. I have an 11-year-old daughter, and I can tell you, it was tough on her and me during the pandemic because she looked at me all day. I looked at her all day. I was like, okay, yeah, you need friends and I need adult friends too. So, you know, I think that's lost in a lot of conversation, that it's flexibility and not pure work from home.
So then how do you manage these sort of dual realities, right? How do you manage this so-called hybrid workplace? And how do you manage the people that do want to work more remotely, who need a little bit more flexibility, who want to come to the office 2 or 3 days a week versus those who want to be back, who liked the sort of old way of doing things? How do you manage that, manage those expectations? And how do you sort of reset how the goals and the end model looks, you know, the entire work model, particularly in a crisis and in this, you know, in this moment of a pandemic?
Doc?
Yeah. You know, can I jump in there? And because there are a couple of things that Johnny said that I want to respond to. The first there are frontline workers who didn't have a choice and they had to physically go into work. I think it's something that we just cannot overlook. And I think your point about those tend to be Black and Brown individuals disproportionately, I think is also an issue that we have to pay attention to. But one thing that we know from our surveys at the American Psychological Association is that those are the folks who have experienced the most significant levels of stress throughout the pandemic. And you know, once the pandemic started, they had the highest stress levels, and throughout the pandemic, they have maintained some of the highest stress levels. And it points out something that we are talking a lot about at the American Psychological Association, and that is, especially coming out of this pandemic, we need to think about health from a population health standpoint. that we can no longer have this strategy of just waiting for people to show up at a mental health clinic or show up at a hospital who are in crisis. We have to think about the environments that people are in now. How do we shape those environments so that they are healthy environments? How do we help give people coping skills and tools that they can use to manage through those stressful periods and through those stressful environments so that they don't end up in crisis? So we have to have a whole mind shift and around how we think about these issues. So that's one of the implications of the point you're making. But I think the other point about the flexibility, you know, what our research shows, both our own internal research and then when we look at the literature, is that there is no monolith. There is no everyone wants to do anything. And in fact, you know, there are people who want to just go back to the way things were before the pandemic, be in their office for 40 hours a week, and that's what they want. There are people who are at the other end of the continuum who never, and have said this, they never want to go back into the office again. They just want to work remotely. And there are a lot of people, and most people are somewhere in between that they recognize that there are there's an importance in going into the physical office, but they do want that flexibility of being able to work virtually. And I think for us as leaders, we're going to have to engage in something that I would say 99% of us have not had to think about in our entire careers. And that's that we have to now engineer a new post-COVID work environment. Because for all of my career, work was, I got up in the morning, I drove someplace, I was there all day, and then I went home. And for most of us, that's the way work was engineered. And so there were a whole set of things we never had to think about. We never had to think about social connections. We never had to think about a lot of the issues that you were mentioning, Johnny, about how do you provide social support, or how do you detect when our colleagues are in crisis. And so as leaders of organizations, we now have to think about a whole set of issues that we've never thought about before, never had to think about. And we're going to have to engineer a new kind of work environment that gets at those things that are missing when we move such a large proportion of our workforce to virtual and to this kind of hybrid environment.
Well, and what I'd say there is we've got to decide, to answer the question that you began to propose, well, it's that, is that right? See, I'm hoping that organizations like SHRM and APA, that we actually do the research. Part of the problem is everyone has the answer, right? And we're just 15, 16, 17 months into this. We need to really study this to determine what are the trade-offs. It could be, and I'm just saying this for the folks who are listening who might say, oh God, he said, no, it could be that net, this allowing people to work remotely is a bad thing for prolonged periods of time. Remember, we responded to this, and I don't know about all of you, but all of us, everyone I've talked to, thought this would be 14 days, 21 days, 30 days. Remember in the beginning, they were like, if we shut everything down, the world down for 21 days, we'll quash this thing and we'll be back. We designed this for temporary, right? It was not intended to be a two-year experience, and now with Delta and then Lambda, no one thought this was going to be what it was. And so we have been building this on the fly. And a lot of what was true 6 months ago does not hold true now. We're looking, for example, at SHRM, we have a pretty big knowledge department with IELTS psychologists, statisticians, you know, all these people who do this kind of stuff, and they're looking at it saying productivity net is on the decline. It's not initially for the first 3 or 4 months. You think about it, you were working remotely, but the whole world was shut down. So it wasn't as if this is different than someone working remotely next to a beach and going out to have coffee in the morning and working out at this time and that time. The whole world was shut down. So there was nothing else to do but work, and we were all scared to death. We are now in a very different world. And so we're not sure that productivity will be maintained just allowing people to work remotely. We don't know that. And the other thing that we're going to, and I want to answer this part of the question, it's important because Dr. Evans alluded to it. We've got to figure out who can really work remotely. You know, we know this in K-12 education. Some kids can do well virtually. Some kids don't. And this idea that just because the employee says, I want to work remotely, this is great for me, that doesn't mean, A, it's great for the employee, and it surely doesn't mean it's great for the employer from a productivity standpoint, an effectiveness standpoint. So we've got a lot here to unpack before we draw these conclusions. There's just as strong of an argument that maybe hybrid is not the answer. Maybe the downsides of having people work, and you know, here's one I want to leave you with. You know, we always talked about the adage, out of sight, out of mind. I personally am curious, and our research people are studying this, what is the long-term, what will be the long-term effects of allowing women to work remotely 10 years from now when we're having to make decisions about who's being promoted? So think about it. The guys all come back to work. They build relationships. They go to coffee, go to lunch, go to everything. The women are at home because they requested it. And I'm generalizing, to be fair. This is not just all women. I want to be clear. But what does that look like 5, 7, 10 years from now when you're making promotional decisions? That's a fair question. Because if, in fact, you've not built those very important relationships in the workplace, two people are equal, but the person who has built the relationship gets the premium and gets the job. What does this look like? We've, from an HR perspective, got to think about that. African Americans have long said part of the reason that we struggled in terms of breaking the glass ceiling and getting those senior executive roles is we had visibility problems. You know, we were very talented, but people didn't see us because we weren't there. We couldn't build relationships with other senior executives because we didn't have access to them. Okay, so now you're going to put a television screen or a computer screen between me and my colleague, and your non-African-American colleague is, in fact, every day having lunch with them. We have to think about the long-term implications of all of this stuff and the net-net, whether or not it's good or bad. That's my point. So I'm worried about the people who are rushing to say this is the way of the future and it's great.
Yeah, but Johnny, Arthur, I would like to get you to chime in, and I definitely want to hear what you have to say. But I wonder if it's time to rewrite those old mores, those old rules that say that you have to have FaceTime, those old rules that say that you need to be seen, that you need to go to coffee, and that the shift should be more about your productivity and the way that you're able to produce at work. Arthur, what were you going to say?
Yeah. I think we are going to have to rewrite a lot of that. And I think the point, I agree with Johnny on this point. I don't think, and I go to it as a scientist. So as a psychological scientist, this is we have a working hypothesis, right, around we think the workplace is going to look like. I think we actually have to pull from at least three different sources to figure out what the new post-COVID work environment is going to look like. Number one is we know we have a body of research that is already out there. We know that principles like psychological safety and other principles are going to be really important. We ought to be using those, people having choice. All of those things are things we already know. Those are principles that are already out there, and we ought to be using those in terms of the decisions that we make going forward. Secondly, we have a year and a half now, probably it'll be closer to 2 years by the time we kind of fully go quote back, where we ought to learn from what the experience that we just had. There are a lot of really great things that have come out of this. You know, one of the things that I say all the time is that one of the things we learned is that our capacity to change quickly is much greater than we give ourselves credit for. We had been talking about remote work and doing many of our meetings remotely for years and just couldn't get off the dime to do it because everyone thought that, you know, the world was going to end if we do it. We actually performed extremely well throughout this pandemic. I don't want to lose that, right? There are some things that we may not have gotten, but I know for one thing is that we performed extremely well as an organization, and people are very satisfied. A lot of our staff are very satisfied with that. So we want to learn from this experience. And then the third thing is we have to create learning organizations so that we are constantly learning, that we don't, you know, the times when we can build an organization and then let it run for 10 years, I think those days are over forever. You know, I just don't think we're ever going to go back to a time when you can just build an organization and let it run. We're going to have to create learning organizations where we build in organizations, we have a set of hypotheses, but we're testing out those hypotheses and that we're making adjustments as we go. And so I think there's going to have to be a lot more intentionality about how we construct our work environments and how we and the decisions that we make so that we really optimize both the, you know, what we've said to our staff is that their well-being is really important, and the efficiency and productivity of the organization is also important. It's going to take us a lot of work to figure out how we create the optimal organization to balance those two things so that we are the kind of organization that we want to be.
Johnny, please. No, I think what I love about this, by the way, is I've been wanting to talk about this. This is why I'm so excited to be here with you all today, if you can't tell. So I want you to think about human beings' natural resistance to change and how very quickly they revert back to it. And I'm just going to, I want everyone to think about this. A year and a half ago, it was socially distant, 6 feet apart, okay? And I was on a television, it was CNBC or one of those, and they said, what do you think will never change? I said, will be a permanent change as a result of all of this? And I said, the handshake. People will not do it, the embrace. Well, fast forward. I walked into an event the other day in St. Louis, 300 people at a conference. The first thing they do is come up and hug and handshake. And here it is. We saw the evolution, right? We saw as soon as the pandemic happened, everyone socially distanced. They were afraid of touching, seeing people, et cetera. And then when it started, then we went from 6 feet to 3 feet to 1 feet. Then people started doing the elbow bump. Then they started doing the fist bump. Now they're back to freaking shaking hands and hugging. The point is, human beings, I know you all are saying, oh my gosh, things are going to change forever. Let me tell you, it ain't that easy. Human beings are going to be human beings. And so we will make some incremental moves. And yes, we immediately shut the country down, the world down, but that's because we were forced to. When you relieve people of the legal limitations, I'm not so sure, and I'm actually answering your question, I'm not so sure that the world is going to like be that significantly different. Now, does that mean we're going to give up on it? No. But from Sherm's standpoint, HR professionals, we are frontline with employees across the globe, 300,000 members, 165 countries. And I am telling you, people are very, very, very quickly converting right back to who they were. And so those norms, those mores, those folk, all that stuff that you talk about, we can say they shouldn't. But it's amazing how human beings are going right back to who they were.
Well, I think it's a both and. To me, it's a working hypothesis, right? So there are two competing hypotheses, that we're going to go back to the way the world was, and that the world will be changed forever, and it's going to be look very different. I think in reality, it's probably somewhere in between. There are going to be some things that we do change forever, and we're not going to go back. And there are going to be a lot of things where we do return. I think that as managers and leaders, we just have to be intentional about those decisions because, frankly, there's some things that I don't want us to return back to. And as a leader, I think we have a responsibility to try to figure out how we take those things that we've learned that have been very positive and how do we move them forward? Because a lot of the assumptions around why we did things just didn't hold up, that we couldn't do this, that we couldn't be productive, that those things just did not hold up when, you know, we were in a position where we had to do them. And so then the question is, how do we learn from that? How do we move that forward? But I don't think we can be passive in this environment. I don't think we should just let things happen. I think we should benefit from what we've learned over the last 18 months.
Yeah. But when Arthur, you talk about organizations essentially being flexible themselves and building the scaffolding to be just as flexible for their employees. I wonder, Johnny, how could that happen or how can that happen? What tips do you have for leaders, particularly of organizations that have operated in one way for so long? How do you think they become nimble? How do they become flexible and shift to this sort of evolving workplace and workspace?
So it starts with a real commitment to culture. The problem is if we call these like initiatives or programs, it's like what we know from diversity, equity, inclusion, then it's a set aside, you do it and you go away. We've got to say this is a part of our culture. We are an organization. When you use the word flexibility, you've got to showcase the behaviors. that you want to see modeled, right? That people can then say, no, this is actually culturally embedded. It's the way they operate. So you can't say, well, we value people who work remotely and we're going to give you this hybrid world, but you're not intentional, as Dr. Evans said, about including those people in all meetings. I know, for example, when I hold a Zoom call, I'm conscious of the fact that those of us who are in the room can sense each other and pick up body, you know, we can pick up a lot of things. So I often, like, very intentionally say, so Janine, you're on the phone. What do you think about this? Like, I'm trying to bring them in. That means we ultimately say to the organization, not only is it just culture, the guiding principles or values on the wall, I have to actually live it out. You've got to live that, and then it becomes culturally embedded. That's going to be the key. We have got to build that muscle that has atrophied, right, in terms of change. Because as I mentioned, human beings naturally, I use the handshake, by the way, is probably one of the most non-hygienic. It's just gross if you really think about it, because you don't know what people do with their hands, right? But somehow people have gone back to it. And all of the science tells you that it's unsafe, particularly forget COVID during the winter. That's how the flu takes off. It's nasty. And we've told people, we've educated them, we've done all of that, and they still do it.
Yeah. And I think we're thinking more about what people do with their hands now because we're so conscious of COVID and coronavirus. One of the things that you talked about, Johnny, that I want to kind of make sure that we touch upon is diversity and inclusion. Yes. After the uprisings for racial justice last year, more employees reported that they wanted to be fulfilled by their work. They want their work to serve a higher or bigger purpose. I wonder how companies and leadership can account for that. Dr. Evans, I'd like to hear what you have to say. And forgive me, author. I know you tell me over and over and over again to call you author. Author, from a psychological perspective, why is it that employees want this bigger purpose now versus 2 years ago when the priorities were different? And then, Johnny, I'm hoping that you can answer from an HR perspective as to how companies can ensure that they are living their values, so to speak. And then we'll open it up for audience questions. And I want to remind the audience that is watching us today to just throw your questions in the chat so we can get to them.
You know, I think this is one of the important things that has come out of the pandemic. And the fact that so many companies are focused on this issue, I think is heartening, because I remember immediately after George Floyd died, I asked people rhetorically, you know, is this Groundhog Day or is this a turning point? Because we've seen these kinds of real horrific incidents. We see, you know, people being engaged around the issue. And then, you know, 6 months later, we're back to normal until the next incident. I actually think that it's been more of a turning point than Groundhog Day. I think we have some more time to figure out whether or not we're going to see long-term change. But, you know, I've been heartened to see CEOs and other leaders continuing to talk about these issues. One of the things that the pandemic showed us, and I think we actually have stopped talking about it as a pandemic and talk about it as a syndemic, meaning that there were a lot of social issues, a lot of social inequity, a lot of other political issues that exacerbated the pandemic. And it was a very complex environment that we find ourselves. So you have not only the health crisis that we know has happened because of the pandemic, but you have all of these other issues. You have a very intense political environment. You have these issues around social justice. You have clear inequities, social class inequities that we saw play out. And all those things have really complicated the environment that we're in and complicated the impact of the pandemic. And I think that mindset of understanding that complexity is something that all of us who are in leadership positions and organizations have to understand. It's not just about the airflow in the buildings that we have, right? That's important. But I'm also thinking about the people who are walking through our doors whenever we walk back through those doors or who are working in our organization who are disproportionately impacted by all of these other issues. And I think we have to take that into consideration. Equity, diversity, and inclusion is one of them. And for one of the things that I have really emphasized both as a leader of an organization, but as I have talked to my colleagues, is that as leaders, we have to make the connection between EDI and our mission. I think it's a mistake when people talk solely about these issues from only a social justice perspective, because there are a whole bunch of folks out there who really don't care about social justice, right?
That's right.
But when we can talk about these issues and connect them to, we're paying attention to this because we cannot accomplish our mission if we don't deal with these issues effectively, then it makes it everyone's issue. When it's a social justice issue, it's only people who care about that social justice issue. When it's, this is about our business, our ability to conduct our, to be successful as an organization, to be successful as a nation, as a community, then it's everyone's responsibility. And I think making that shift is going to be important for our long-term success, our ability to sustain our efforts around this. And I really believe that. You know, one of the things we're doing at APA is taking a look at the impact that psychology has had on perpetuating some of these ideas. And we know that there are psychologists who, you know, were eugenists and perpetuated a lot of these ideas. We know that psychological testing was used to say that there was a human hierarchy, that there were some people who were better than other people. You know, so our field has contributed to a lot of these issues. We're taking that issue on. We're taking a hard look at the role that APA may have played, that our field has played. And we're not just going to apologize. We're going to apologize and then follow up with a whole series of things that we can do to redress those issues that that we know have been problematic. I think that that's the kind of commitment that all of us have to have. And the reason that we're doing that is that ultimately we'll have a better field. We'll have better scholarship and research because we'll have more diversity. We'll have better ability to deliver services because we'll have people who reflect the populations that we're trying to serve. So connecting these issues to our mission, I think, is really critical for our long-term success.
And what I'll say is absolutely, this is one of the most difficult issues for us to deal with in the workplace. Mm-hmm. And partially, it's because it's a little bit of what Dr. Evans said, we have not been honest about the conversation around diversity. We here call it inclusion, equity, and diversity. Some have it, you know, change the alphabet soup. Some have a B in it for belonging, A for access, whatever you want to call it. And I think words do matter and order matters. But what I will say is this, we are now, sometimes I worry about our overcorrection by totally, you know, taking the concept of IE&D and focusing on civil rights diversity. We ignore the various, you know, 30 or 40 different dimensions of diversity. And in doing so, we may undermine the entire deal. So what am I saying and what we're seeing in the workplace now is we talk about psychological safe spaces. Well, by the way, that has to apply to everyone. And that's really difficult when you bring people together and say, it's okay, white male, for you to be psychologically unsafe, but we're going to make these other people safe. That's creating some real tensions in the workplace. It's okay to say that, well, you can go to a BLM march, but you can't go to Charlottesville march. Diversity is diversity. If I want to put a tag on the back of my car that says Biden for president, then someone else should be able to put one on the back of their car and pull into this building and say Trump for president. That's where we're beginning to struggle, is we mean diversity as long as we agree with it. And that is creating some real tensions in the workplace because the people are saying, well, this isn't really about diversity. This is about, you know, someone has an agenda, there's activism here. And so we in the workplace are trying to reconcile that. When we say we welcome diversity, then we've got to be prepared to welcome diversity. Now, obviously there are limits. We don't want to get into hate speech. We don't want to get into anything that condones violence, but that's where the workplace is struggling right now, is what we call our IE&D initiatives are being called on the carpet for not being legitimate, because you're not really interested in diversity. You're interested in carrying a particular point of view, which is in some ways absolutely the opposite of true diversity. So that's what the challenge is for us right now.
And so what I hear you say, Johnny, is that some employers are struggling to understand how diversity and inclusion can be free of the politics that it can sometimes carry with it. We only have a couple minutes. This has been a great conversation. I just want to give you both at least 30 seconds to answer this one question that has popped up in the chat and that has come up in the chat earlier all day today, which is just some advice for employees who are being asked to deal with these shifts. They're told to work from home, you know, very instantaneously, and some are being told to, depending on where they live, to rush back to the office and start that 40-hour in the office work week again. How do you recommend making this adjustment easier, especially for those who have a preference of either working in the office or working from home? And that question comes from Carnice McFarland. 30 seconds, and then we have to say goodbye.
Go ahead, Johnny.
Empathy. I've talked a lot about it. There's an empathy deficit in our country. And so at the time you're talking about rushing someone back to work, ask yourself the last time that you've been rushed into doing anything, whether it's a purchase, whether it's a relationship, whatever it is, it's uncomfortable. So we're asking, and I would encourage you to build within your organization the empathy muscle so that as you ask people to come along with you on this change journey, that you're empathetic to how they are experiencing it and all of the negatives that are associated with them having to experience change so quickly. So build on empathy culturally within your organization.
Thank you so much, Johnny. Thank you so much, Arthur, for this wonderful conversation. Unfortunately, we have 5 seconds left. I'm going to encourage the audience to please join us in the cafe afterward, the networking cafe, where we'll be talking a little bit more in the chat. Thank you again, APA, for having us. This has been a wonderful conversation. Farewell.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.